your biggest adversary as you grow up the ladder, and something that you had so much of in abundance, unless you learn at a very young age at the start of your career to channel it and master it, only then will it continue to be your ally when you're in the top of your game. And the reason I'd like to share this story is, when I first joined law school, the most surprising event was not my mother being depressed that I was out of the marriage market, which itself was surprising, but the most shocking aspect was the law school was on strike for 7 days, and at some point they were attempting to light a police station on fire, which was within the law college campus. And the most surprising part was that was not unique. There were 80% of government schools are on strike at some point of time. And then you have to make a decision, right? Whether you're fresh in college or fresh out of college and just starting your career. And I see many of them, we have a mixed audience, right? Young, old, experienced. So the way you utilize time is of paramount importance. Learn to make it your ally, leverage it as much as you can, and it becomes much more easier to maximize efficiency later on. The second word was, and it directly relates to the topic, was leadership, right? And there are many individual components to it, reputation, the ability to take charge, the ability to inspire others. But it is not a thing that you exhibit or traits that you exhibit once you achieve it. You know, when you talk about things like reputation, I think Mysore Prasanna, if he's still here in the audience, I think was talking about reputation a little earlier. Once you are established general counsels, once you have established partnership, it's very easy to take ethical decisions. There's no consequences to your decisions. You will always have money in the bank. You will always have more customers. It's easy to be ethical when you're in a position of power. It's when you're starting off your careers, and I address my younger audiences, it's when you're not having your client base. It's when you're just starting out, where a consequence of a lost client means a lost meal. And that's 80% of the lawyers of India, right? It is at that time you have to take reputation and integrity and ethics and take a stand, because that is what will define you later on. So the one statement, the one single sentence summary is, these leadership traits, don't wait to become a leader to exhibit it. So when you talk about things like reputation, integrity, the ability to inspire, train others, receive training from others, because the best leaders are also the best followers. Exhibit these traits before you become a leader. Because it's the same thing like time, right? What you have plenty of, you might not have enough later on. And leadership, you don't need to become a leader to exhibit those traits. So that's the second word. The third word is a little strange. Girish, is he in the room with us? Maybe it'll appeal to him. We were talking about astrology outside. So apparently after his legal profession, he does a lot of astrology and reading of people, okay? So keeping that topic in mind, my third idea is called intuition, all right? For the scientific-minded, we'll call it pattern recognition, and this is very important. Some of our panelists address it. Our primary role in the company, legal advice is a commodity, actually. In this day and age, it's a commodity. You can go to 20 law firms, get the best deal, and what's the big deal? It's an easily legal advice, quality legal advice is the most replaceable commodity. Where your role as general counsels differ is marrying that legal advice to the company's business profile, analyzing the risk, and providing that risk mitigation strategy, right? But how will you know that without knowing the risks that you face? And now the risks you face may be in litigation, it may be in HR, it may be even while you're drafting a contract. And this is the controversial part. Your brain will be capable of anticipating events. So this is what I call intuition. When you start off, you won't. But as you gain more and more experience, your mind will be able to foresee and you will analyze just when that risk happens. Now for the scientifically minded among you, how does this actually happen? So in Iraq, they were testing war veterans. They would just walk by that road and they will know, by the way the cars are parked, there's a potential suicide bomber there. And the scientific explanation for that was called pattern recognition. The irregular placement of cars leads to a suicide bombing. A sports person knows when was the right time to kick that goal, not just out of intuition, but because of the placement of the rest of the field. So similarly, you as lawyers, when you're negotiating the deal, just by the way a customer is pushing for certain clauses, you will anticipate the type of risk they are foreseeing in your delivery mechanism. In your litigation, you will know when exactly to go for that preemptive, interim, interlocutory application, interim injunction, and learn to train that, anticipate events. So whether you call it intuition or pattern recognition, it's up to you, but train that sixth sense, and that will set you apart from everybody else. This is just stuff I picked up on the way. And the last word before I get my other far more esteemed co-panelists on stage is happiness. All right, I feel so many of us lose track of this. So if you, you know, people follow leaders, people follow happy leaders, people follow leaders who are at peace with themselves. And now I've seen so many young, bright lawyers, and what's been Cognizant's story, right? To just give you an anecdote. I was the first lawyer hired in 2008, and we've grown it to a nearly 90-member team today. We have lawyers in Philippines, we have them in China, we rolled out our first letter in Australia. So you get some insight into the human condition, right? And now they'll say, oh, but this partner, this senior attorney is working day after day after day. That works for that person. Some people just working, learning, knowledge, and making more money is happy for them. But for some person, it's a family life. And so learn that this profession is a means to an end. This pays your bills. You know, this gives you name and recognition in society, but eventually all goal in life should be happiness, okay? So some people, just because they're working hard, it's a formula that works for them that might not work for you. So leverage your time, leverage your leadership in the pursuit of happiness, and that will make you a well-rounded, well-balanced individual.
I reached out around, and I would say I reached out to law firms, I reached out to international law firms and so on, other counterparts in other banks and stuff. To ask, so what is it that a GC does? What is it that I should now sort of look at what I have to do? And you had a constituency which is looking to you. You're looking, your businesses are looking to you, your functions are looking to you. And there's an evolving environment. The evolving environment is, for instance, in the US, there was the SOX Act which had come into force by around 2003. We had already, as a US-listed company, we had to face that as a requirement. We were at ICICI growing our international business. So we had international, we were going international at that particular point in time. And we had various businesses within India itself. So how do you actually come around to dealing with that? How do you acquire the trust, so as to speak? I think it starts quite early in your career. And again, to the younger folks, the older gray head have already probably made a journey which you know, in some ways, I guess, resembles mine. It is nothing short of what I would call hard work. I think people appreciate sincerity, people appreciate hard work. And the second which I would say is probably having this anticipation of what is relevant in your sector, what's relevant in your industry, which is on the anvil, which is about to come around. For instance, I knew ICICI was interested in getting into insurance sector, right? We'd already inked a JV with Prudential. So we were just waiting for the insurance laws to be sort of promulgated, and we would make an insurance application. When insurance laws actually got published, I must have been maybe 2 or 3 years old within the ICICI career path. A friend of mine and I sat over the weekend, and we analyzed the Insurance Act threadbare. Right? So we said, if we are an insurance company, what do we need to do? How? What does it mean for us? What are the case laws around that subject? And what we found is, because insurance had been nationalized from 1956 in life and by around 1970s in general insurance, the body of law had not developed around insurance as a subject, right? What had developed was, because it was public sector, there were various demands and various things which the courts would say, you are ultimately a public sector undertaking, you have to do a certain activity in your life. We looked at policies of other insurance companies, and we found they were verbose, they were structured in a particular environment. A case law came, so there was a new clause added to the same insurance policy without any cross-linkage or whatever. Now, that weekend homework, and it was not one weekend, it was a couple of weekends, both of us went back to our respective organizations and said, this is our analysis of what this law is saying. What did that mean in my personal career? What it meant was that when actually the insurance company was going to come on stream, they said, well, we are making a registration application. Can you be involved in that team? This is the license we have got. We want to now roll out our first insurance products. Can you get involved with that? Now I'm saying it was very quickly getting involved because there was an initiative taken. It was something I anticipated along with a friend of mine to say, yes, this is a sector which is about to open up. So I would say, watch your sector. You are part of various organizations where obviously there are developments which will be on the anvil. Some you will know because you are part of that. Some you are probably asking for. Having said that, the other challenge was really, I was a young leader, and there are perceptions about young leaders. We are impatient, we want to sort of make our mark very quickly and so on. But there is another human dimension. We might have people older than us working as part of our teams. How do you sort of carry them with you? And they have to, again, have the trust and confidence to say, either the management has made a right choice, and this is a person we can work with, or no, this is a person we probably want to bring down or detract from. And I'm saying I was lucky in being in the first category. I had a set of people who said, yes, we probably know where we are at. We want to work with this gentleman. And I could sort of invest or reinvest in their careers to make them as relevant as I was. And to me, the simple answer lies in this. My constant focus from the time I became GC was to say, how can I make myself redundant in the various aspects where the business head of a business says, I want Pramod's view on this. And to me, it was to say, can they say it's the next level's view that they want? Can they say it's the level below them that they want? And that meant making sure they were in the room. They were the ones voicing the opinions or whatever, which we would then say, this is what we would like to do. I think creating that redundancy for yourself is what then gets you the next level of function, the next level of leadership. Without preparing for redundancy, and I'm saying again, so you can say, I want to hold on to everything I have. And, you know, yes. But that also means that you're not creating or grooming the next set of people. So to me, when you are prepared to share your knowledge, prepared to share your experiences, making yourself redundant, is when you will have greater opportunities for sort of growth. The third is, which comes along, and I'm saying listed in India, listed in New York, is board. The board comprises of very strong independent directors. And for them it is, we want to see such and such person at a risk committee. We want to see them at audit committee. And they know their stuff. So when they ask you questions, you have to know your stuff. So I had to learn about accounting standards on the way. I had to understand when the chairman of audit committee means to ask X question, how does it translate back into A, legal dimension, and B, accounting dimension. When the risk chairman, and we had folks like Marty Subramaniam of NYU, and when he talks about risk, he talks about various different kinds of stuff again, right? And we are a bank, we are into Forex, we have volatility indexes and so on. How do you connect that and still grow your own knowledge base? Because you have to be able to respond when they pose a question to you. I think all of that is what we need to keep on reinvesting in. There will be these different constituencies. They will ask these questions of you. And to me, I could find the time to spend in these board committee meetings only because I had a next layer, which was actually doing the transactional work, which was actually attending to the businesses. They knew when to involve me in. Right? And if I said, I want to be involved in everything, believe me, I won't have had either the aspiration or the ability to work with the board committees, to work with the chairman, and so on. Finally, yes, there is failures also mentioned somewhere in that little bit. There have been failures along the way. For instance, I would say, in some respect, my first career choice after law school was to actually join a firm. Right? Within 3 weeks of joining, I knew that was not my cup of tea. Well, after spending 16 years at ICICI, again, decided I'll join a firm. Now you can ask me, so why did you do it at the stage you did it? Because at some level you end up feeling that yes, there is something I want to test on that side, right? I'm back being in-house after a year of having tried to be on that side of the fence. And if some of you have seen the interviews I gave, because there were various people who had various questions around it, to me it was only to say, I needed to experience this, right? I work with external counsels quite a lot. What is it that drives them? How is it that they think? And it was very, very relevant in some senses when I'm back in-house to say, yeah, I know the other point of view today, right? I was constantly in-house right up to I took this decision. And when I joined that very first month, I'm saying I was obviously the most junior most in that firm. So there was no way that I would have got the kind of logic. And why is it important again to know? I'm saying they are our most visible partners. We as GCs, we as legal department work with external firms. You have to know what drives them, what drives their economics.
In the team, there are different personalities. What makes them think? I learned this a really hard way. When I made partner, which was at 32, I was one of the youngest partners. My trainee was older than me, the law firm where I was. Everybody was older than me. Everybody had been to Oxford or Cambridge. Everybody, or vast number of them, would either have gone riding ponies, sailing, rowing, the Oxford Cambridge boat race, I didn't relate to any one of these things. It's that that struck me. I'm a real oddball here in these law firms. How do you connect with them? And my connection was sport. Not that I was very good at it, but I was very keen and very enthusiastic. And that was my way of building a network. They could always use someone to play cricket on Monday evenings. And that was me. Come hell or high water, I'd always leave a slot open between 5 and 8 o'clock on Monday evenings to play cricket. So every team in the firm knew that there is one guy they can rely on. And that'd be nice to me because most people wouldn't turn up for the cricket game. And they were playing clients. So my way of building a network was to actually figure out what's the one thing that can connect me with everybody in the firm. For me, it was cricket. I wouldn't have tried rugby, but thankfully cricket. And having a name like Pulley actually doesn't hurt. So to me, it was a way of connecting with these whole lot of people, building this network, and reaching out to them very differently. Some places it was food, some places it was movies, some places it was music, sport, obviously. Not always the law. There's a human being out there, and that is my story with my clients as well, is we connect to them at different levels. They assume it was the law. For me, the connection was, what is it in that person that I can relate to? The books they're reading. I don't watch many Hindi movies, so that's one of my failings. But I do try and watch it because I think it'll make interesting conversation with somebody else. It's a burden in some ways of being a leader, having to try and do things you would normally not do. But that's a way of connecting to a lot of people. Food is another thing a lot of people connect to. I'm a teetotaler vegetarian, in the sharpest sense of the word. And I must have done at least about a dozen beer deals, beer acquisitions, when I was in London. And I promise you, I learned a lot about beer, without drinking too much of it. And so it was a need. And the joke was, if you wanted to do a beer deal in London, pick the one guy who doesn't drink it. But it worked. And I can talk intelligently about beer, thanks to that experience. So the point I'm trying to make is, it's one of those things that I find from people who led me and I look up to as leaders or mentors, they're able to make a personal connection with every person in the team. It's not the same connection, and they're perceived differently by different people. And that's perfectly okay. I don't think they morph their personalities, it's just that the way they relate is very dependent on who the other person is. So, you know, they can be soft, put an arm around the shoulder and get people to move. Occasionally, some people need to be kicked. Some people need to be just left alone to do their thing. Some people need constant encouragement every day, tell them, you've done a good job. Or tell them, you know, this is what you need to do better. Some people are good at last minute stuff. Some people like long lead time. For me, that was a great learning as a leader, is they treat each individual in their team, understand what they're taking, and get them to do that, and deal with each of them separately. And others don't see it. And my favorite example is, leadership is not a title, it's not a position. People are just acknowledged as leaders. And very often, there is no publication that says these are the 100 leaders. The teams know who the leaders are. It doesn't matter if you don't have a title. It doesn't matter if somebody else doesn't call you a leader. I think the best leaders are the invisible ones. They're the ones who know they're leading. Everybody else is doing what they want them to do. And the example I've given several times is Tom Sawyer's story. He got the picket fence painted. I think great leadership. Everybody felt happy doing it. He sat down, counted the marbles, all the gifts he got, and he was very appreciated as having done everybody a favor. To me, that's the epitome of leadership, is getting everyone to feel they're having a good time, they've all made a contribution. No one's actually seen it as this huge picket fence being painted. It would take a month for him to do. He got it done in one summer afternoon. To me, that is a very inspiring story for me, and I say it to a lot of people, that for me, that is what leadership is. Nobody would think of Tom Sawyer as a leader. But I think that is the greatest sense of example of leadership in that little story of a little boy on a summer's day with a boring summer chore got it done by everybody else. I think it's the same story he said, you know, he made himself redundant. I just say it's the Tom Sawyer story. 7 lawyers in the commercial team did 1,200 contracts last year. Nobody's actually recognized it within the organization. So when I put it out for the first time in January to leadership, they were shocked, appalled that people had killed themselves to get 1,200 contracts done last year. And these are not Mickey Mouse contracts, CDAs. You know, these are supply agreements, customers on the other side, in all these parts of the world that nobody considers civilized. And nobody had actually acknowledged this. As soon as you
And probably matched by a businesses which probably had that many per contract to manage it.
Exactly.
And I think that equation sort of gets them, right? Because they know how many salespeople have they deployed in that area or what other processes that they've laid around it.
Exactly. If you look at the finance team compared to the legal team, you know, there's one finance person supporting every business. And most of them in these parts of the world would be sub $10 million per annum. And the finance team is like 50 times the size of the legal team. And you just say, how is it very different? Same throughput, we're doing it with 7, you're doing it with 200. Let me put it in perspective for you. I think then they appreciate what we do for them. And then the perceptual issue of you're coming in the way of our deals then gets balanced out by how much work we've done. I used to do it as outside counsel to law firms, to clients as well, when I was in the law firm, to say, let's have these meetings. Let's talk about how we can be better, but we need you to acknowledge the good work that my team has done and encourage clients to write to associates, encourage clients to write directly to junior partners in my team, partners in the global team where I was leading in other parts of the world who were part of this team, and you had a firm client doing something, small piece of work in Vietnam, a small piece of work in Hong Kong, or in Italy or somewhere else, to actually encourage clients to write to them, give me feedback, and ensure they give them feedback as well. And one of my clients told me very early in my career that feedback is a gift. Good and bad, both ways, feedback is a gift. What you do with it is really up to you. It's a free gift. Somebody's given it to you, not compelled to give it to you. You receive it as a gift. What are you going to do with it? And so to me, this feedback, even now, I think works very, very well. It makes clients more receptive to lawyers. At the same time, lawyers understand you need to be showing some empathy to your clients. And this positive feedback, I found to be quite useful.
Right. I'm just going to say something perhaps not too controversial. When it comes to managing bandwidth, the overarching expectations of the business team vis-a-vis the limited resources that you have in your team, one of the most crucial questions you have to ask yourself is, are you working for a good employer? All right? Because believe me, there are companies here that will work you to the bone and work on an attrition model. I'll hire this guy, I'll work him for 2 years, he'll go out, the next batch comes in, we'll invest like 30% of my budget on training a replacement cost, and this is a model that is used by a large number of companies. So I would recommend, especially in the positions that you are, understand whether this uptake in bandwidth is a cyclical issue which will be addressed by future hiring. Do you have that management support that acknowledges that you need to make the investment either in technology, in resources? So always do that first bit, and assuming that we have a good employer, all of this kicks in. But you'll be surprised that a number of times when you have burnt out attorneys, it's law firms, in-house roles, it's a bad employment practices at play. If a guy is working on Saturday, you know, till he protests, let me continue calling him or her on a Saturday. So, you know, it's very important as leaders in your team, as you rightly said, while you set expectations, for you to proactively, you know, create that fence that Saturday, Sundays are off hours, but at the same time, draw that distinction on mission critical deals. And you will have the luxury of doing that only when you're in partnership with the management and you're with a good employer. And make sure you have both when you're walking down this path.
I agree. Will the audience have? I can see one hand there.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Sorry.
Okay. So
you can also introduce yourself.
Own inspirations of your team members. I understand if you have 3, 4, 5 people, it is easy to, you know, relate to them, you meet them more often and all that. What happens in a larger organization or when you have a larger team of, you're saying 170, how do you, you know, on a every year basis, you're supposed to do performance appraisals. You're supposed to know where your team is, whether they're happy, they are not happy, how challenging it is when you really go into a larger team.
When I left ICICI, my team had grown to about 400 plus lawyers. So I used to tell Cyril, of course, that we are competing with you because he has a 1,000-member aspiration for his firm. But I think the way to do it, and the way at least I connected, was one, to make sure that there were reviews scheduled, which allowed me to see the people for themselves, the team members. You know, it's very easy to just interact with your direct reports and one level below, but not really come across your team members at all. Setting up the reviews actually allowed me to see those team members, get them to open up, get them to speak. The other thing was to actually, and again, it's not just in one location. So if it is spread out across locations, I'd make an overnight trip. So I'd say the previous evening or, you know, stay back one evening and actually just do dinner and drinks with them. Just to say, guys, I'm here. We finished the review. Now, can we just open up? Can we talk about what you are planning? Where is your family? What's your children doing? And I think a lot of it goes a long way in being able to associate when you actually come for the performance appraisal. Because you're getting already people who have evaluated them and putting up recommendations to you. And then you are in a position to question and say, you know, but that person made a valuable contribution when I was doing this review. Or I remember this distinctly. Those kind of connects are what I found quite valuable. Again, you know, it's really all of us, but we operated under, I would say, very tough economic conditions. There was also a time I would try and get people under one roof and get them to appreciate what the other team members were doing. Because what tends to happen is we all follow bell curve at some level or the other for distribution of bonus, for, you know, promotions and whatnot. And people tend to then say, why is that guy a high performer and I'm not? So getting the team under one roof and for each of that team leader to sort of showcase and say, this is what we accomplished, the point you were making, Murli. But equally to the entire team, when somebody has done some big deal, to actually showcase and talk about it. But equally, when somebody has handled a lot of matters which might not otherwise register in the economic radar, but clearly has taken up a lot of bandwidth, that is one way that at least I found of making sure the team understood where each of them were standing.
Yeah, I think I've done a combination of things. One is, like I did for the commercial contracts people, we did for the trademarks people. Much underappreciated in most organizations because they think it's just form filling, get the bloody thing out, we don't care. In Cipla, we have 2,000 products in 180 markets. And each of them is critical to what we do. You can't just, it's not like Pons or FMCG products which you have a common trademark around the world. The laws are so different, the language is so different, requirements are so different, that people don't appreciate how much of an extra effort it is to do it. And so I did the same thing to put it out, one slide to say, this is what the trademark team did. And it shocked everyone, including the trademark team, when we actually put this out for everyone to see. Same thing with litigation. You know, they've got hundreds of cases all over the country, all over the world. How do we actually get them to be seen as achievers? And I give the example of the hotels. Everybody sees the pretty people in front office smiling away, welcoming you, saying nice things to you. Nobody sees housekeeping. They're the people who actually make the whole thing work. And they're the ones who, if they don't do their work, ruins your experience of the whole hotel. But you ask people who do these different roles, they always think the other one is a cushier job. I have a terrible job, the other guy has it easy. Look at the people in the front office, they wear pretty clothes, lots of makeup, and see the people when they come in and leave. We have to deal with the crappy stuff in the background. Shower is not working, I need a toothbrush, you know, bring me food, why is this not clean, why is this switch not working, all of the problems. And then you hear the front office guys pitch what their day looks like. And they will say, we have to stand the whole day, most of 8 hours they're standing, they're smiling, and having to deal with people who really don't want to be there. The worst time to see somebody is when they're checking in or they're checking out. They've come from somewhere, they don't really want to be there. They want to get to their rooms or do something else. Similarly, when they're checking out. You ask kitchen, they will say the same thing. You can't, you know, it would make a sailor blush, the kind of language that happens in a kitchen. And they will say, so I take the same thing when we do legal teams, give them the example of how it happens here, and try and do activities around it. So I took them to Smash. I've done it several times. So they realized this guy really can play and how difficult it is to actually play. It's very easy to watch it on TV and say, what an idiot, how could he have got out to that ball? Here's a bat, there's the ball, show me. They just find appreciation for their colleagues, they find appreciation for other people who don't show off how well they have done.
Or are not in the glamorous side of
glamorous side of the business. And so there are things I think we can do to make this happen. The one other thing I do is actually find excuses to work with a person at the bottom of the chain. So I'd like them to actually come and send me a piece of work they're doing. And it's very random. So the CLO decides, this is a piece that goes to Murali to see. And they then get a one-on-one interaction with me on that. They then feel, you know, here's the boss who notices what I'm doing. I matter to him. And usually it's a good piece of work. So they get some appreciation right from the top. When a deal closes, I try and get our global CEO to write, or anything happens. It might just be an injunction application, some criminal proceeding stayed by the High Court. Usually try and get someone from
acknowledged,
the top
right,
to send it to say, well done. This is really important to Cipla. And it is. We don't want a managing director standing in a magistrate's court. So it is important to Cipla. But the fact that they hear it from the highest office, say thank you for saving me 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, and the embarrassment of standing in the magistrate's court just perks them up till the next 6 month period. So I found these two things to be quite helpful in keeping, you know, people doing supposedly mundane, boring jobs in the same Tom Sawyer mentality, is they get encouraged to keep doing it.
Right. You know, to address that, the core of your question, right? Performance management in large teams and your interaction with them, right? It's very easy. You're right, 100 plus people, you tend by just the way the work structure and the workflows to deal with your direct reports and perhaps one level lower. And now why is it important, right? There's actually a very commercial reason, because in today's world, you know, ethics, morality, it's all superfluous concepts, but for sheer commercial and good management reasons, and maybe it's published in some books, but what I learned the hard way, right, when you're managing a team, you read books on management styles, you see other leaders and their management styles, and you're like, okay, so what is the best management style to adopt for my team? And it took me a lot of time. It was actually 3 or 4 years after managing a team, I realized you're customizing your management style per employee. And that was a big learning curve for me. What do I mean by that? Now, unless you have a certain degree of interactions with your associates, your team members and your colleagues, you don't know what they're going through. I'll give you a practical example. If I had a child, the same attorney, male or female, one is even more motivated to work even harder because he or she is worried about paying the bills. The same attorney in a different state, male or female, doesn't matter, is not equally motivated at work, but is more focused on work-life balance. So now your ability to manage your team changes, and your management style changes not just across varying team members, but across that same team member in various types or phases of their career. Now, how do you do this, right? Don't fall into the trap of interacting with them during performance appraisals. That's like, it's a disaster way. Nobody likes performance appraisals, and to judge that person and say you are 1 on 5 or 3 on 5. And this bell curve system, Microsoft has rejected it. I hope other companies in India do it. Very simply, this is a very bizarre concept. So ideally, if we rate in this people in this room, apparently only 20% is intelligent, 20% are fools, and the rest 80% are. I think it's a bizarre, it's an insult to good hiring practices. It's an insult to our good lawyers. So essentially, don't fall into the trap of interacting with your more junior team members, the more younger team members, only during performance appraisal. Make time. So how does Cognizant do it? We have team outings once in 2 months, whether it is a paintball tournament or whether it is just a racing. Those team building activities go a long way. Building team building and building a relationship on a transaction, it takes a Herculean mind, and you know, you're more interested in deal closure. It's very hard. So create that time at least once in 2 months for the entire team. Once a year, all the top law firms do it. Cognizant took our lawyers to Thailand. Was it expensive? Yes. Is it a luxury company that can, you know, it's a bill to pay, right? 60, 70, 80 people taking them. But the amount of team building, that spirit of brotherhood, or again, I don't want to use a gender offensive term, but that sense of we are one team and enabling that across the level, you have to consciously make the time consistently and translate that spirit, that relationship, into visible goals for the company, which is eventually how you get funding for those team activities anyway. So anyway, that's my response.
Almost I have completed 33 years. in the, as a general counsel. 21 years, State Bank, NTPC, SAIL, and then Reliance, Junior Mittal, Steel, and then SR. Let me tell you very frankly. According to me, the leaders, a successful leader, he must be always a learner and always recognize the good work of his subordinates. That is the key success. That is the key point, according to me. I started, like others, career at the 23 years. The first All India written competition for law officer selection in State Bank, Radhakrishnan was the. So we are from the first batch. That time also we were taught, never think about what the other says, whether you are popular or not popular, don't worry for it. Be honest to your profession. We never believe that we are a popular general counsel, not a popular general counsel. I have not come across in today, even 33 years, that any organization says, oh, law department is a very comfortable department. They always say, oh my God, you are calling a legal guy, he will have some point. So number one, never think that you are popular or not popular, honest to your profession. And both for in-house counsel and my colleague Prasanna, senior Prasanna ji and Grace will agree, unless you know the technology, the business, like if you are working in a steel plant, if you don't know Fe content, what is sinter, what is blast furnace, if you are working in a telecom, you don't know a spectrum, you cannot draft a contract perfectly. Let me tell you very frankly. I take it very in a positive sense. Because like you, I am also a LLB graduate. When I started with State Bank, we were sent to a branch to learn what is the relation between the what you call locker. Is it a lessor or lessee? So unless as a lawyer we know what is the relation, how we will deal that problem. So first thing that never bother about popularity. Number two is always think yourself as a learner and recognize the subordinate. That is my suggestion to everybody. Thank you very much.
I have done it timely because I believe as hurried is buried, delayed is also denied. And usually, a human being, as the science says, has a receptive mind only for 45 minutes at a time. And after that, it becomes boring, however intelligent it may be going on. So it is better to stop the session, but don't blame me because you are only blaming me, a messenger. The real person is sitting behind, who has been telling me to control it in time. Having said so, we had various discussions on the various subjects. Mergers and acquisitions, in my opinion, that session was the excellent session which was there. Again, due to sparsity of time, they could not, because I was signaling them, probably they could not take up the topic about the competition law and its impact on the mergers and acquisitions, but rest of the topics were covered sufficiently. And this is the comment I have received from the Competition Commission. So I'm just delivering that comment. About the in-house lawyer's role, lot of the things were said. I also personally believe that never compromise on your dignity and on your professional work. At the most, you will lose one job. But at the risk management session and everywhere we were talking, about the reputation risk, your reputation continues beyond the organization and it was there before the organization, therefore you were entering that organization. So therefore never allow that reputation to go. Don't think that the people don't listen. If we say it with the logic and a positive mind, it is always appreciated. I am not ready to believe that in my organization, because I have worked in a company like Larsen & Toubro, Tata's, multinational called Lafarge, and a promoter-owned company, Jindal. And this, I don't find much, there was a much difference in the management approach towards us. It was either good in every organization or it was bad in every organization. Rather than blaming, we had to find out the solution to it. Like the case which I told you in the morning about which I said I took the call disregarding the opinion and terminate the contract. Discussion was there between me and Mr. A.M. Naik, and all of you, those who know, you know A.M. Naik is a bulldozer. He doesn't listen to anybody. But then he told me, you are telling me like this, but why is the, what is the reason that I cannot, there is no termination clause. So I told him, sir, termination clause only enables the termination. It doesn't give the right of termination. That is inherent. He said, nahin, Gokhale ji, humko ye nahin pasand hai. Kaise batao? I said, sir, I will give you the only simple example which touches everybody's life. Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Jain, Buddhist, all the religious ceremony, there is no provision of divorce. But the divorce takes place with the alimony. So can you say that because when I underwent the marriage, there was no provision of divorce, there was no clause of divorce even under Special Marriage Act, I accept to be his married wife. There is no provision, there is a provision, there is an alimony. So termination clause also has the alimony. So you have to come out and convince. He convinced and he took the action. Role of an in-house lawyer, basically, we are not Chanakyas. Please don't think that the management has to listen to us, and if they don't listen, we will have to take some action. Because the managing director and the chairman is equally responsible for the company and he is equally loving the company. It's not that the care for the company is a sole prerogative of a general counsel. It's only our job is to give the correct information, professional required information, put all the points so that the considered decision is taken by the management. And thereafter, nobody blames you. Or you yourself don't feel that had I been able to point out this, probably the decision might have been different. That is our role. And management not accepting sometimes our advice is neither a reflection on your ability or either professional ability or their confidence in you. Because every time, you know, as we don't share everything with our management, they also don't share everything with us. So there are some compelling reasons for which they take that particular decision, but then they are aware that the decision is taken despite this having this knowledge. So therefore, our position, I always consider, if I go to the Indian history, is like a Vidur. He told his Maharaj that whatever you are doing is wrong, but then thereafter implemented with the expected efficiency and competency the decisions taken by the king. He never thought of changing the king. Earlier character which I told, Chanakya would have changed the king. Well, Vidur said that I will accept. So I always accept the Vidur's role that I will do my duty to the best ability, but I will not challenge unnecessarily because there is a Lakshman Resha. As in a politics and in a government, we find out that executive, legislator and the judiciary are a different wings. Like that, our role is synonymous to the judiciary. We have to decide. We may not be deciding, but we have to give an opinion. But executive will ultimately take a decision. So please don't feel bad that if our management doesn't listen to it. And that is the main thing many of the times heartburning comes. Secondly, do we know the law? Apart from the law, do we know the facts of the business, the metrics of the business? We don't know. We want to know, but we want to be the decision maker without having a knowledge. That is not our domain. So please don't expect to do that. Please learn it like that properly. First the law, first the subject, and for that go to the factory. Go on the floor shop and then you will learn what are the realities of the business are. Business has not done, it is very easy to say under Section 7 and Rule 17 it can be done or it cannot be done. But we are not paid for that. We are paid that despite Section 7 and the Rule 17, how it can be done. If it can be done, and if cannot be done, please say it cannot be done. Time pressures have been mentioned. I always accept that in any business or anything, time pressure, that as we expect from the management, every 3 months the promotion, they also expect every 3 minutes of some deliverable from us. But I used to always tell everybody, look, legal department will do the best of the efficiency and competency, we will not let you down. But at the same time, I have not opened the Domino's pizza shop that within the 30 minutes I am bound to deliver. And I never delivered it like that. I will deliver it in my own time. Another issue which is there, which is I think is that role of a general counsel is, you know what, in the constitutional law, the question used to be office of the prime minister, what he or she wants it to be under the Indian constitution. If we are good, tell me you don't, if you get a good doctor, if you get a good friend, if you get a good artist, don't you go to him again and again? Or it is required to be told, so and so is good, you go. You yourself go and you market for him. So if you add the value to the business that, okay, I can not only tell you no, but I can give you the solution also, then only he will come. Otherwise, who will come to the, why should the managing, you expect the managing director to come to you for an advice when you can't give him an advice of coming out of it. You can't give him the advice, okay, this is the way in which the deal can be structured. This is the way it can be done. Last point, many a times I have seen the legal department people saying, We have to work on Saturday, Sundays, we have to work overnight, we have to do this, we have to do this, we have to do that. Please do it. Because one must remember, Bhagavad Gita says, Nahi jnanena sadrusham pavitram iha vidyate. There is nothing so pure and better than the knowledge in this world. And the knowledge always remains with you. Yet no program has come from HR wherein you say that while leaving an organization, I will leave the domain knowledge back to the organization and I go as a blank to some other organization. So that organized knowledge always remains with you. So you are only improving your own character. You are only improving your own market value by working. And unless you don't swim, you cannot be a swimmer. You cannot be a swimmer by learning the lessons on the TV. That you float like this and you push it like this or push it like that. So you have to be a swimmer, you swim it, then only you will learn it. And that is how only you will be able to go and the management and everybody will recognize you. I also have to keep a constant. I am reducing it by 3 minutes. Thank you.